for us redemptorists to go out on retreats. When we have retreats, we especially have parish missions where we visit the parish for a week and in some cases 2 weeks. Now the first step of our retreat is to have the house visits. So we visit taking 3 days or depending on the parish, sometimes even 5 days. We have all the priests who will preach the mission, plus we invite our seminarians, the brothers, those who have their habits, who look like priests, and all of us come together the first day of the retreat, and we start our house visits. We start the house visit by sending each priest or brother into the different prayer groups or the different regions of that parish. We normally announce in the parish that we are coming and that we will be visiting the homes, and we will have the parish soon after we have visited every house of the parish. So once we have visited everyone, we have said, and we go there and say, we are having the retreat in the parish and we would like to invite you personally. And we make sure that every family is invited to the retreat. Now, there are a lot of funny experiences that we have during this occasion of visiting the homes. One of the worst and embarrassing one I had was where I had a dog run after me or frighten me out of the house because the owners forgot to lock the dog in the kennel. So I was forced to run out of the property to make sure that I don't get bitten. So that was one of the most embarrassing experiences that I had as a priest. But there were other occasions when the families were kind of embarrassed, when probably they forgot the day that the priest was going to visit their home. And so comes in the priest, he rings on the bell, the family comes to the main door and looks in through the keyhole, the door image, and tries to see who is actually outside, and gets the shock of their life saying, "Oops, we forgot. Today is the day that the priest is visiting us. And look at our house. A total mess." Now we ring, and normally we have the prayer group leaders or the house leaders of that region who accompany us to the various homes. So this person, we ask them to stand outside. We ask them not to come with us in the family in case the family wants to speak something confidential to us. So luckily this man was out. But he saw me ringing on the bell and nobody opening the door. So he asked me, "Father, should I come there and ring or call them or ask for them?" So he went to the neighbor's house and asked, "Have this family left the country or are they traveling somewhere?" The neighbors all said, "No, they are there." So I got the prayer group leader's answer saying, "Father, they are still in the home. Ring the bell longer. Maybe they can't hear you." So I said, "Okay, try it again." I could hear some ruffling inside the house. So I've had this experience before, so I guessed and I said, "Okay, they're probably preparing the house inside, cleaning up, tidying up, because they were not ready for the visit." So I just took my seat and I said, "You stay there and talk with the neighbors, I'll just have my seat and just relax for some time." So finally the family comes out, all blushing. "Hello, Father, welcome to our house, it's nice to have you here, we were waiting for you." I said, "Yep, I heard that inside." So many times this is actually a very embarrassing experience that families have when unexpected guests come home, when you are not prepared. But on the contrary, we have had a lot of houses, a lot of families who are actually prepared, who wait so eagerly saying, "Yes, the preachers who come home," especially in India, preachers who preach in the retreats are considered as holier people than normal priests. They are conceived to be people who pray more, people who spend more time in fasting and penance and so forth. So people actually prepare extra food or extra drinks or something special to welcome the guests. So as we go home, we make sure and we have announced to the church, do not give anything to our priests. Because what happens is this, we visit at least 50 to 100 homes a day. We start early morning, and by evening, 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock in the evening, we finish the house visits. So just imagine if we were to receive a drink, a glass of water from every house, and sometimes they just don't give you water. They give you the sweetest of juices that they can make, and they offer you that. And that makes us so tired. So we are forced to say no to everything that we get. And we say the best gift you can give us is by coming to church to attend the retreat. Now, this is a moment of great joy for them to see that the priest at least drank one sip. Doesn't have to drink the whole glass, but at least one sip of what they have prepared, and they feel happy for that. So finally, we end up doing this every home, one sip and say thank you. Now, I try comparing this joy to that joy of the prophet Simeon and the prophetess Anna. Today we read the shorter version of that gospel. Two prophets, Prophet Simeon and Prophet Anna, were people who stayed in the temple, who always lived a life of holiness. And they were awaiting that one day there would be a beautiful child that would come to their temple, who would be the Christ of the Lord. You've got a lot of lovely babies here. Try to imagine how a little beautiful child who is all smiley and bubbly is brought to you. You automatically, by seeing the child, you automatically have a great smile upon your face. You would have a lot of joy coming to you. Now that would be any ordinary child. But here we have Simeon and Anna who are confronted with none other than the Lord, the Christ, who they have been waiting for many years, eagerly waiting to see who this child would be. Try to imagine having one of our elderly men who live in the church here, waiting for many years, let's say 5 to 10 years, he's waiting eagerly to know when the Messiah would come. Try to imagine what he would be doing. Every time we had a baptism here, he would come running. Is this the child? No. So what did he get as a sign? The Spirit who was with him, the Spirit who was upon him, guided him and said, go to the temple now and you will meet the Christ of the Lord. You will meet that child who will bring forth, and as he himself says, my eyes have seen, O Lord, your salvation. Your means of salvation, O Father, through this little baby, I have seen. And he expresses his joy so much, saying, I've waited so long for my death. Now, Master, take my life. Take my life. I'm ready to leave this world because I have been eagerly waiting for this moment to see my Lord, my Savior. Now he proclaims and introduces Jesus in this way. Jesus is the one who will bring the light to the world of the Gentiles, and the one who will bring the glory to the people of Israel. Two things that Jesus is pronounced to bring. One, light. Jesus himself says, I am the light of the world. And today we reflected that by carrying that light along with us, and baptism the parents, light the candle from the Easter candle and share that light with the child by saying, my child, receive Christ, the light of the world. Now this is again a beautiful symbol of saying we are receiving Christ into our lives. Now here we have Simeon who proclaims by saying that Jesus is the light of the world to the nations, to all nations. And he specifies by saying even the Gentiles, meaning the non-believers. Until then, in that time of the world, the Jews believed, or Israelite people believed, that we were the chosen one of God. We are the chosen nation of God, the special people. But here comes Simeon with a message that Christ is not only for the chosen one, but he is for all the nations, even the Gentiles, even those who did not believe in Christ or in God. So he announces the salvation brought by Jesus to everyone. Everyone. Now when I thought about this, I was thinking about Christmas. The time of Christmas we all celebrated with great joy, and we remember Christ in that. As we have the Candlemas today, we remember Christmas in that way. And Christ is the focus of Christmas. But if you look at the world today, you don't see Christmas more of a memorial for Jesus or Christ. It is more of a seasonal greeting. People who greet, everybody greets Merry Christmas, a Happy Christmas. But they forget that it's all about Christ. Not just a religious leader of a religious group, but Christ, the Savior, the One, the Word itself, Christ, meaning the Savior. So somehow, we forget that aspect. But today we are reminded again in the presentation of the Lord through the words of Simeon, who says he will be there, not only for those who believe in him, but even for the Gentiles, for the whole world. He will be the light that will remove all darkness. Again he says, for the Israelite people, those who believe in God, those who are faithful to God, those who live their life in faith, for them he will be a sign of glory. So in short meaning, each and every one of us today here who come together around this altar to profess our faith and to live our faith, you will be glorified on behalf of this profession of faith that you have just done. By this very act of you being here in the presence of God, your act of faith, your act of humility, that allows you to share in the glory of Christ, who himself was glorified through the cross, through his suffering, through his passion, and thereby glorified in the Heavenly Father's presence. Brothers and sisters, each and every one of us today are reminded that we will have darkness. We will have difficulties. We will have challenges around us. But amidst all that, there is a light of hope. That there is Christ who shows us the way, who is the truth, and who fills us with his life. So today as we celebrate this month, let's thank God for this beautiful theme, this beautiful message that we can reflect upon. Take with your hearts as you go back home the message and the light of Christ. Go back and share this light with someone else who you think is living in darkness. If you see someone in pain, you see someone in agony, the best way of you being a Christian and living your life as a Christian would first and foremost be by your prayer and your penance on behalf of those who are suffering. The second act would be your act of compassion, of you reaching out to them as Jesus himself would do. Today there are many among us right now who are suffering. Many among us who are carrying a lot of burden, a lot of pain. What have I come here to do? To think about myself alone? To pray for myself alone? Or have I come here as a family, as one big family, to pray for one another? As we stretch out our hands and we pray one prayer that Jesus Christ taught us, how does it start? Our Father. It's not, Jesus never taught us, my Father in heaven, holy be your name. He taught us, our Father, reminding us that we are one beautiful family that comes together in prayer, in worship, in honor to this God, and share in that glory that he himself has. Amen. Amen. With this faith now we shall rise before the Lord and profess that faith and tell him,